Psalm 63. O God, you are my God. Early will I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh longs for you in a dry and a thirsty land where there's no water. So I have looked for you in the sanctuary to see your power and your glory. Because your loving kindness is better than life, my lips shall praise you. Thus I will bless you while I live. I will lift up my hands in your name. My soul shall be satisfied with marrow and fatness. Can you say my soul? My soul shall be satisfied with marrow and fatness, and my mouth shall praise you with joyful lips. Can you say joyful?
Joyful.
I said joyful.
Joyful.
It's okay to smile, folks. It's okay to be joyful in the house of God. In fact, if you're just joyful in the house of God, you're missing it. You should be joyful in your house. Amen? There should be joy in the house. Amen. Joyful lips. When I remember you on my bed, I meditate on you in the night watches. Because you've been my help, therefore in the shadow of your wings I will rejoice. My soul follows close behind you. Your right hand upholds me. But those who seek my life to destroy it shall go down to the lower parts of the earth. They shall fall by the sword. They shall be a portion of jackals. But the king shall rejoice in God. Everyone who swears by him, being God, shall glory. But the mouth of those who speak lies, they shall be stopped. So David, he expresses that he's in a place where there's no water. There's no water. For the 11 of us who went to Kenya, we know that that was an English colony. And so they don't say water, they say wata. And this became a little of an interesting conversation. And one of our brothers in Kenya, he says, you Americans say water, but it's wata. And when you say water, we're like, what are they talking about? Water. What's water? And so it became quite funny. Caitlin's actually quite good at saying water. And the British on British Airways were impressed by her ability to say water. And so it became a fun time. But there's something about water that is necessary for life. Amen. You have no water, you got no life. Amen. No water, no life. And so here David is in the wilderness of Judea. He's on the run. We took a couple of weeks, and I could probably take a couple more, but I won't exactly. But he said, as long as I live, I'll praise you. And you can't praise God if you're dead. Only the living shall praise him. So you got to make sure you're alive. Amen. Right? Amen. You got to be alive to praise him. Only the living can praise God. The dead can't praise him. Only the living can. And Christ has come that they might have life and have it more abundantly. So only the living can praise God. Only those who have had a transaction that took place from God giving you something you didn't have before. It's called eternal life. And when you have life, you can praise him. In fact, there's a praise inside of you. But he goes on to say, in a dry and thirsty land, he says, my flesh longs for you and my soul longs for you and my flesh faints for you. So my soul longs for you. So we have this picture of a dry, barren, arid land where there's no water. Water is a source of life. Especially when you go to the Middle East and you see that water is life. All the peoples migrate towards. In fact, as we look at the very history of the scriptures and how man ended up where he was in Israel when God, the descendants, after they were cast out of the garden, and we see ultimately Abraham becomes the main character on the scene, and he's moving, and his whole tribe is moving towards a place where it's well-watered, right? The Fertile Crescent, well-watered area. In fact, it says of the Garden of Eden, that it was a place that was well-watered, for four rivers met at this particular place, and it was a place that was full of life because it was full of water. There was water everywhere, and therefore there was life. And so, but David's finding himself in a dry and arid place. He says, oh, Lord, that I could be in the place where there's water. I thirst and long and faint for you. Point one this morning is this. We live in a dry place. There's no water. There's no water. Amen. You ever find yourself dry and barren and parched, and your strength was waning, and your mouth was dry, and when you don't have what you need, you become a little bit agitated. Amen. And you can get a little tough to deal with. Maybe that's just me. But we live in a dry and barren place where there's no water. There's no water. And David was longing for the presence of God, because he knew that his true source was not just a temporary fix. He's like, my soul is barren, but I need water. Anybody need a drink of water this morning? Thank God for the promise of in the book of Acts that God would bring seasons of refreshing by the Holy Spirit. And I'm praying, God, and I'm speaking, Lord, that you would let that be so, where there's just a place where the waters begin to flow, where the rains begin to drench, and where the life begins to spring out, because the Holy Spirit is revealing the source of true life, the true water that comes down from heaven. Mark had posted something the other day that there's four necessary components of life. What are they? You need air, water, bread, and light. Without those four things, there's no life. And Jesus reveals that he's the source of all those things. Amen? He's all those things to us. And we see here that there's a place where there's no water. There's no water. You've definitely felt that way before. You ever felt dry? I mean, it's an expression we use in our spiritual life. I feel dry. I feel empty. Anybody ever used that expression before? Like in my spirit, I feel like I'm in a dry place. I feel like I'm in a barren place. I feel like I'm in a dry zone. I feel like I'm not satisfied. I'm not quenched. I'm longing for more than what I have right now. I'm sure at some point within your life, some of you are there right now and you just feel like there's a dry place. If you turn over here just a little bit further into the poetry books, into Proverbs in chapter 11. I want to look at one verse that's been going over and over through my mind this week, and I knew that I was supposed to share out of this one verse. Chapter 11, Proverbs 11 and verse 25. Proverbs 11 and 25, and we'll spend most of our time here in this particular verse. So David made it clear that there was no water. Amen. But he thirsted and he longed for God with his soul, with his soul. My soul longs for you. My soul longs for you. That word soul used so many times in the Old Testament, representative of many different things, but there's this inner longing, there's a desire that is deep within that yearns. And David was saying, from the very core of who I am, I yearn for you, God, to see you in your glory and your power as I did in the tabernacle, in your house, in your gates. Verse 25 says, the generous soul will be made rich, and he who waters will also be watered himself. There's one, the generous soul will be made rich, and he who waters will also be watered himself. And we're going to get back to this in a moment, and we're going to just break this down a little bit. And I was thinking about this aspect of water, and when you have experienced water, when you've longed for water, and when you've experienced it, the desire ultimately is not to get all that you can have for yourself and not understand the need of another. But ultimately, we're going to get to that place. And one more verse, I want you to turn to John chapter 4. And there's a particular instance where Jesus has an encounter at a well. And many of us are familiar with that verse, the portion of Scripture in John chapter 4, the woman at the well. I mean, it's called the woman at the well. And there's this woman that meets Jesus at the well. The disciples, they've grown hungry, and they go off looking for food into the city. And Jesus stays there, and he's sitting on the mouth of this well, and a Samaritan woman, she comes along during the heat of the day, and Jesus is sitting there and has a conversation, engages her with a conversation. She's actually taken aback at the fact that a Jewish man is having a conversation with her, a Samaritan woman. And it's right there in John chapter 4. And reading from verse 11, Jesus ultimately says to her, I want you to get me a drink. And she's like, why are you talking with me? And verse 11 says this. The woman said to him, sir, you have nothing to draw with. And what Jesus ends up saying to this in verse 10, Jesus answered said to her, if you knew the gift of God and who it was who spoke to you and says to you, give me a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water. Living water, amen, you know that, right? He would have given you living water. And then the woman's response in verse 11 is this, sir, you have nothing to draw with and the well is deep. Where will you get this water? And that's a question that probably many of us have asked in one way or another. Lord, how are you going to get down there? Do you know how deep that well is? Point number two this morning, we live in a dry place. The problem is the well is deep. Can you write, the well is deep? The well is deep. The sources are below. The well is deep. And she says to Jesus, you got nothing to draw with. Her whole point of context is this, that she only understands natural things. She only understands natural things. And Jesus wants to reveal spiritual truths so that even her natural can be transformed by the spiritual so that she could be a source to another. And we're going to see that Jesus is actually setting her up to be that very thing, that her life would be an example that others' lives could be touched through. Here he is sitting at a well. I don't think it's an accident that this is where he will meet this woman, because he's going to teach us what Proverbs 11 says, the generous or the liberal soul will be made fat or be satisfied, and he who waters himself will be watered. That if you water, you'll be watered. And so Jesus is sitting at this well and says, she says to him, the well's deep, the well's deep. That's a point we have, and you got no bucket, you got nothing to draw with. Where are you going to get this water that you're talking about that satisfies? He would have given you living water. Give me this water, because if you drink from this well, you'll have to come back to this well again. But if you drink of the waters that I give, you'll never have to come back to this well again, because there'll be a well, there'll be a source that's from supernatural from God. Anybody with me this morning? Third point, just a brief point. I don't have a lot of time this morning. The source is God. We live in a dry land. The well's deep, but the source is God. The source is God. Amen? Let's just go back to Proverbs 11:25 here for just a moment. Because some of us sometimes think that the solution to our problem is something other than God. And we get ourselves in a little bit of a mental quandary and a spiritual conundrum when we think that God is not sufficient to meet the needs that we have. We have this sense that you don't know what's going on in my life, Lord. The problems are deep. The well is deep. The issues are deep. The things that I'm going through are deep, and you don't know how to get down there because you got no bucket. We think that that God is not capable of getting into the places that we have. Now, we'll find out in our spiritual life that the source is never digging deeper within ourselves. It's a supernatural exchange that God does within our lives. God begins to open something up that didn't exist before. And in fact, in verse 12, as Jesus said this, he's going to do this. The woman says, are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us this well? And he himself and his children and his livestock, they drank from this well. Are you greater than Jacob? We'll address that in just a minute here. We don't have a lot of time, but I'm trying to pull this together. So go into Proverbs 11 and 25. This is what the proverb says. That the liberal or the generous soul will be satisfied himself or made fat. We're going to find something out is that a lot of times the source of our problems is ourselves. We're so worried about us that we've lost touch with everybody else. When you lose touch with everybody else, you're in a very dangerous place spiritually. When you become selfish, when you become self-contained, when you become self-evaluating, when you become so worried about your problems and your need and your desires, which are there, and guess what? They'll be there again tomorrow if you keep drinking from the same well. You just keep coming back to the same well, and you'll find a satisfaction that's temporary, but you're going to find yourself right back here again the next day, tomorrow, needing to fill up the bucket again because that bucket continues to run dry, right? And so Jesus was offering her something that was beyond her own understanding, but she was so used to it. And now Jesus begins to open up. We know, we talked about that a little bit further on, earlier on in this month, about being complete in Christ and how this woman was so incomplete that her relationships, one from another, just brought her to more and more incompleteness. But that's not what we're talking about here today. We're talking about a well. Amen? A well. To go back to Proverbs 11:25, it says, the generous soul will be made rich, and he who waters will also be watered. The word generous in the Hebrew, and I talked to Garrett this week, was able to FaceTime in with him, and he was actually going to FaceTime in with us this morning. We were supposed to connect last night. Didn't work out. So next week, we're going to have Garrett FaceTime in and the Cook family on the projector. We're going to be able to, you're going to have some conversation with Garrett next week. Does that sound cool? And so we're going to hook that up this week and have Garrett come in from Israel. And so we talked to him, FaceTime in with the family this week. It was awesome. We love them so much. And just to see them, they're all getting tall, you know, Faith's legs are all long now. And they're just a beautiful family. We love them so much. And Garrett was telling me he just started his language study, so he's learning Hebrew. And he said literally his brain hurt. And he said, you know, because Hebrew, English we write left to right, but Hebrew they write right to left. So you're using the other side of your brain. And so he said even scientifically, when you're studying this way and you're using parts of your brain that you're not accustomed to using, literally your brain can actually start hurting. So people said, my brain hurts. His brain was literally hurting. He's like, it's like so much, just sitting there for hours and hours and hours trying to learn something that's so contrary to what you're used to. You know, you notice how we always revert back to what we know, right? I used to hate post moves. Like we practice and play about, and so you foot this way, and it's like you always revert back to what you did, and they're trying to teach you something new, and it's like you can't teach an old dog new tricks kind of thing, but that's not true. It's just about whether you're going to be stubborn or not. But anyway, in the Hebrew, this word generous is the word baraka, B-R in our English, B-R-A-K-A-H, baraka. And it translates 69 different occurrences. The King James translates it 61 times as blessing, 3 times as blessed, 3 times as present, 1 time as liberal, which is this occurrence right here, the King James. So this is the only time it's translated as liberal. 61 of the 69 times is translated as blessing, right? 3 times blessed, 3 times is present. And 1 time it's translated as pools. So there's this whole issue and this idea of water, amen? How many people know that the blessing of God can be associated with water, amen? And so the generous soul, or the blessing, or the blessed soul, will be made rich. That word rich could be translated fat. In fact, if you remember in Psalm 63, David said that my soul shall be satisfied with abundance and fat. And the word he uses is a related word. It's this, you got verb, noun, same word, but in the different use of it, as this word fat here. That the soul that blesses, in other words, will be himself blessed, or he will have increase. And as we begin to understand this principle that we live in a, when you live in a dry place, you're not worried about anybody else. You're worried about yourself. When the well's deep, you're worried about how do I get something for myself. You're not worried about how can you distribute to other people. Because when you're dealing with getting something that requires labor, the more we want to keep it to ourselves. Let's be honest. Come on. The more you work for it, the more you want to keep it. If you worked hard for your money, you hold hard to your money. But easy come, easy go. Amen? But most of us is not easy come. And therefore, it's not easy go. It came hard, and I'm holding on tight. And most of us deal with that but every aspect of our life, right? Our time, our energy, our resource. And it's like, you know what? This is mine. You know, I work hard for it, and I want it to myself. Think about it. Our free time, we protect it very much. I'm not giving my free time up to go to Bible study. I want to go watch the game. I want to kick my feet up on the couch. I want to take a nap. We don't want to be, because Bible study is about what I can get from it. A lot of times it's what can I give into it? How can I bless another person? Do you not know that it's a body at work together to see the body encouraged and edified? It's not just about what you can get from it. If you go to church for what you can get from it, you've missed the whole point. Preaching myself this morning. So this word baraka, generous, I believe it's what God wants us to be. Over the next couple of weeks, I'll deal with this issue of he who waters himself will be watered. And we're going to wrestle with this just a few more minutes. I know I got to move through this. But the first time this word baraka is used in the scriptures, and I think first time a word's used is a significant thing. In fact, the first time this word is used is found in Genesis chapter 12, a very important passage of scripture when God calls a man named Abram. Do you remember when God called Abram? And this is the words that God spoke to Abram. He says, I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great. Remember that in Genesis chapter 12 and verse 2, right? He said, I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and I'll make your name great. And then he says this, and you shall be a blessing. Just one word, baraka. Blessing. How many people know God only needs one word to pronounce upon us incredible, long-lasting, all the nations of the earth being affected blessing. How many people know it just takes one word from God, baraka. And he says, and all, right? And you shall be a blessing, baraka. You shall be a blessing. Here's the first time the word's used. So the proverb writer says this, that the blessing soul, or the generous soul, or the liberal soul, or the refreshing soul will will also be made rich or be refreshed or be poured out upon that. When you give, and here's, we're going to wrestle with this a second, because oftentimes you talk this way because we know the whole principle of give and it shall be given unto you, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, men shall pour into your bosom. And we think, wow, I'm going to give so I can get. And we're like, play the spiritual lottery. Like, if this person has need, if I give them $100, I'm just waiting in my mail. When's the $500 going to come? And we've missed the whole point. We're thinking, I bless for the purpose of being blessed. And we've missed the point. It's principle. It's not saying bless so that you'll be blessed. It's saying bless because you've been blessed. Right here, God is dealing with Abraham. Abraham will become a key figure in the Old Testament. How many people know Abraham is a key figure? And God is meeting him and saying, you, through you, all the nations of the world will be blessed, and you shall be a blessing. Baraka, you shall be a blessing. It's interesting because number two, number three, and number four times the words used in the scriptures are all in relation to one account, and it's found in Genesis chapter 27, and it's referring to the individual whose name is Jacob, which brings us back to John chapter 4, and this woman asked Jesus, are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us this well? How many people are intrigued by Jacob? Anybody intrigued by Jacob? So we know that Jacob is what? The grandson of Abraham. And so he's in the line of Abraham's blessing. He's in the line of Abraham's blessing. So he's going to be blessed, and nations are going to be blessed through him because God's promise, God's covenant with Abraham, the Abrahamic covenant. And Jacob, however, didn't have right perspective. And in chapter 27, we have a particular instance take place, and if you remember, his brother Esau comes back from a trip, and he's wearied out, probably hadn't had any water. Think about it. He's exhausted, he's famished, he's dry, he's parched, and people say something, why would he give himself to poor? It's like he's going to die. He's like, I'm going to give and die. He was willing to sell his birthright for a cup of stew, but in that stew, we had water. How many people know you can't live 7 days without water? Water is a necessary component of life. Actually, when you're without water, maybe he was out for a while, he didn't find, or maybe he went on a chase of this particular animal to hunt it down, and he got it, but it kept on going. And so he kept on going after it and found himself maybe in unfamiliar territory, and maybe he got stuck. We don't know what happened with Esau, but he came back, and he was completely wiped out, famished, to the point where he was willing to say, whatever. You got to be careful when you're in such a dry state that you don't make decisions in a dry state. I said, when you're completely exhausted, when you're completely famished, when you're completely just drawn out and you're pushed to make a very major decision, say, you know what, we'll deal with that tomorrow. But often out of necessity, we just like, you know what, whatever, it doesn't matter. We don't think about tomorrow when our immediate comes right now. When we're pressed in a situation and it seems like I need this right now, we forfeit future blessing for our right nows. We got to be careful how we deal with our right now when we're in a dry, in a barren, in a wilderness place. Don't make decisions there, folks, that are long-lasting and will impact your future. So Esau comes back, and Jacob sees this as an opportunity. And you know, he steals from his blessing. And we go on, he sold his birthright first, but after he steals his birthright, he goes after and he begins to dress himself up like his brother with his mom's help, and he goes into his father, who at this point is old and blind, and he tries to steal not only the birthright, but now the blessing, Baraka. And so three different times the word Baraka or blessing is used in chapter 27 referring to Jacob. How many people know what Jacob's name means? It means supplanter. Does anybody know what supplant means? Deceiver or heel snatcher. In other words, grab someone's heel. How many people know when you're running and someone grabs your heel, that's not ever really end well? You know, we used to play that game when we were kids. You know, you walk beside someone and you kick them in the back of their heel, and we're nice kids, you know. But and everybody's laughing because you've done it before too, so don't be pointing fingers. But he was heel snatcher, he was a supplanter, he was a deceiver, and so he deceived. And in chapter 27, in verse 12, verse 35 and 36, the second, third, and fourth occurrence of the word blessing are dealing with Jacob basically stealing the blessing from Isaac, from Esau. And the woman asked Jesus, are you greater than our father Jacob? And I want to just take just one more minute to think about this. So we live in a dry place. The well's deep. Amen? But the source is God. How many people know you can't steal God's blessing? You enter into it. You don't have to steal a gift. It's free. Many people are trying to deceive God into answering their prayers. We're trying to convince God that we're good enough. We've got to convince God that our need is great enough. And we don't understand this whole aspect of really what it is to be blessing. If you are generous in your life, guess what? Blessing will follow behind you. I believe that with all my heart. I want you to just look at this for 1 second. Are you, verse 12 says, are you greater than our father Jacob who gave us this well and drank from it himself as well as his sons and his livestock? Catch this principle, and we're going to move towards closing. A soul that seeks blessing will supplant. A soul that seeks blessing will supplant. But a soul who satisfies others will be supplied for further blessing. I said a soul that seeks blessing will supplant. But a soul who satisfies others will be supplied for further blessing. One who's seeking blessing in order to even supplant, we see that in Jacob, but a soul who satisfies will himself be supplied for further blessing is the person Jesus. Was Jesus greater than our father Jacob? And the answer surely is yes. Amen? Amen? Psalm 84, verse 4 says, blessed are those that dwell in your house, they will still be praising you. Verse 5 says, blessed is the man whose strength is in you, whose heart is set on pilgrimage. And verse 6 says, as they pass through the valley of Baca, they will make it a spring, and the rain also shall cover it with pools. And the word pools there is the word Baraka. The only other time it's used as pools is this particular occasion, Psalm 84 and verse 6, that the place that's called the valley of Baca, and the word Baca could be translated weeping. The valley of weeping. When you find that the Lord is your praise, blessed are those who dwell in your house, they shall ever be praising you. Blessed are those whose hope is in you, whose heart is set on pilgrimage. You see what David's heart was in Psalm 63? I just want to be where God is. And he says this, that even in the valley of Baca, even in the valley of weeping, even in the dry and arid places, those places will begin to burst forth with blessing, Baraka, pools. That the rain will cover them and pools will begin to break out. The message I used this morning, titled, Well With My Soul, is this is what I want to talk about today. That God has made us to be a well. And our soul is to be satisfied with good things, so that we are a source for those in a dry and barren place. So that we ourselves could be those who bless. See, it's not just about everything's good with me, but it's about us learning how to refresh the souls of other people. Because if the land is dry, the well is deep, the source is God. The fourth point in closing this morning is this, there's enough to share. I said there's enough to share. You shall be made rich or fat. The Hebrew is deshan or deshain, which is mean to be made fat, grow fat, become prosperous, or anoint. In fact, in Psalm 23 and verse 5, this word used in regard to being made fat, David said this, thou anointest my head with oil. It's that same word, fat. In other words, there's a saturation, there's anointing that comes with those who dwell in the presence of God in liberality, in generous. And who are givers. Amen? So to go back to Baraka and generous, first occurrence is with Abraham, I'll make you a blessing, and you shall be a blessing. All the nations of the earth will be blessed through you. And then verse 3 says this, and I'll bless those who bless you, curse those who curses you. And in you all the families of the earth will be blessed. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said, blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. The generous soul will be made rich, and he who waters himself will be watered. In closing this morning, the first occurrence of waters here is the Hebrew word rava. And it means to water, to make, drink, fill, satiate, or abundantly satisfy. In Psalm 36 and verse 8, it says, they are abundantly satisfied with the fullness of your house, and you give them drink from the river of your pleasures. For with you is the fountain of life, and in your light we see light. The verse before that says, how precious is your loving kindness, O God. Therefore the children of men put their trust under the shadow of your wings, and they're abundantly satisfied. This idea of watering is that very thing, to abundantly satisfy the needs of another. Not just to give them just a little bit, but to abundantly satisfy, to water those. Those who water will themselves be watered. We're not talking about a sprinkling. We're talking about a satisfying, a satiation, a complete covering. When you learn the secret of generous, liberal, when you learn the secret of not just enough, but more than enough, when you learn the secret of overflowing and abounding in your giving, then you're going to become one who can't help but escape blessing, that everywhere you go is blessed. You are blessed in everything that you do and everything that you touch. If there's a secret that I've learned in my life, it's this. When you learn to be generous, God will take care of your needs. You don't have to worry about your needs. God will take care of your needs. And you don't have to seek blessing and seek supplanting others in order to be blessed, but you'll learn the secret that when I bless, I actually identify with Jesus Christ. I'm not seeking anything in return, but you can't help but walk in the blessing and the favor of God when you walk as one who waters another. When you water and you water and you water, you find out that there's a soul source that will never run dry. You'll find out that the well is deep, in fact, and the source comes from God, and it's inexplorable. Amen? And it's inexhaustible. And God will, through you, become a blessing. And I was thinking about this week, and as I'm getting ready to close here this morning, I want to ask you a question. Are you set on being a blessing? Like, have you set your heart on how you can bless? I was talking with the brothers just the other day, and he was saying, I don't really have anything natural. Silver and gold, I don't have. But you know what? God's not talking about our stuff. He's talking about his stuff. See, we are a blessing because we've been blessed. Jesus said, I have water that you don't know about. See, you might think there's a well and there's source there, but you come back and come back and come back. But there's a place that David was trying to find in the wilderness, that my soul longs for you, O God. My flesh fails for you, O God. And when he finds that source, that you are satisfied, that you are satiated, that you are filled, that you are overflowing, that you are abounding, that you become a blessing to the people around you, and you learn to satisfy and meet the needs of the people around you, and God continues to give you everything that you need. In fact, the second word, because it says he who waters will be watered, it's not the same word water in the Hebrew. The second word used for water is actually translated many times shoot or to throw, but the one time where it's dealing with water, it's the early rain. It's the word for early rain. I remember Joel, and Joel said that I will give you the former rain and the latter rain, or the early rain and the latter rain, and it had to do with harvest. In fact, the early rain was a rain that fell in Palestine or in this region from, I think it was late October until early December, and it was the beginning of the harvest season. It was the water that was needed. It was the rain that God sent that was necessary for the harvest to be put into effect. Another rain would come later that would bring it to fulfillment. But this is the one that caused it to be a blessing, that there would be any type of a harvest in the first place. He said, I will give you the early rain. In other words, the person who waters, I'll give you the rain. That when you learn to satisfy the needs and satiate the needs of others, I will send the rain. Come on. And so when we learn the secret, the liberal soul will be satisfied with fatness, with abundance, that they will be full. And when you learn to satisfy the needs of another, God will give you the rain. I say, God will give you the rain. So many people pray, God send the rain. God's saying, why don't you go out and saturate the souls of those who need a touch? This is a dry land. They have no deep. They have no way to get into the well. It's too deep. They don't understand its sources. You understand its sources, God. When you learn to touch the needs of another, I will send the rain. That's my promise. We're asking God, and he's made it a contingent clause. If you do, I will. We say, God, send the rain. God said, I'm sending you. And when I send you, then I will send the rain. And when we begin to walk into our fulfillment of calling, God has promised he'll send the rain. Is anybody ready for the rain? The soul who waters himself will be watered. This word means something, folks. So I want to ask a question this morning, because I'm completely convinced of this fact. I don't even understand what's going on with people, but it's this. We've lost direction. We've lost our sense of who we are. We've forgotten how much we have. Our abounding and our abundance is not found in the things that we possess. We have a source that's way greater than the possessions that we have. We look around us and think, I don't have enough of this, that. You have more than you need. Jesus said, I've come that you have my life and have it right to the fullest degree, to the fullest measure. The thief comes to kill, steal, and destroy. He's based on supplanting. He'll make you a blessing seeker until you begin to look to Jesus, and he came not to seek his own, but the needs of another. Let's be honest with ourselves. Much of our modern day Christianity is seeking blessing, not seeking to be a blessing. I'm not saying we do this so we get the rain. I'm saying we do this because this is what we're called to do, and God has promised he will send the rain. You with me this morning? Saturate, satisfy, fully satisfy the souls, the needs of another. We live in a dry place, folks. There's a lot of churches in our region that are struggling. One of these days, the seams are going to burst. We're going to have more than we need. And I think we've got to keep perspective. that we're not blessed just to be blessed. We're blessed so that we can satiate. We're blessed so that we can fully satisfy. We're blessed that we can meet needs. We're blessed that we can invade the darkness, that we can invade the dry places, that we can be a source of refreshment. I prayed, God, make this place an oasis. Make this place a deep well. Lord, we rename the place the well. You know, just make this place the well. Lord, make this a place where we are satisfied fully. There's overflow. There's abundance. And Lord God, you continue to send rain so the sources are never, never empty. They're never dry. And there's always enough to share with all those around us. See, Jesus was worried about that woman because she was interested in her. Not what he could get from her, but he was interested in her. And he was interested in every person in the town that she was going to go back into, because not because he needed anything from them, but because he wanted to bless them as well. And Jesus taught us a lesson that when you walk as a giver, God will continually freely give. He'll just freely give. There was never a place where Jesus didn't have what he needed. Even though he continued to empty himself, you'll never show me a place where Jesus didn't have what he needed. You'll never show me a place. Even when at point I thirst and they gave him sour wine, you don't understand what it is I'm thirsting for. I don't need, I long for. When your longing becomes God and you learn to be a blessing, you can't help but walk in blessing. With every head bowed this morning, can I ask you a question? Have you followed the example of our father Jacob, and you're willing to supplant to get on top? Or do you want to find the one who's greater than our father Jacob, who gave us this well and drank from it himself? It's Jesus himself. His source will never run dry. And he who drinks of the water that I give will never thirst again. For the water that I give shall bubble up over into everlasting life. And then in John chapter 7, Jesus, on the last great day of the feast, he says, "Ho to everyone who thirsts, come, and I will give to drink freely of the waters, and the waters that I give will flow out of his belly like living waters, like a river." And this he spoke concerning the Holy Spirit, whom had not yet been poured out because he had not been ascended, that Jesus wants us to be a source of refreshment in a dry and a barren place where the wells are deep, where the hearts are faint, where the flesh is failing, and God is saying, "Go and give a cup of cold water in the name of a disciple, and you shall in no way lose your reward." And so, Father, this morning I pray that the word of God would have impact in our lives. I pray, Lord, even as we walk out into the callings that you've called us in, to bless, Lord, we remember the word you spoke to us today, to trust you in everything, Lord, to trust you and to put our hand in the hand of the man who calmed the waters, to put our hand in the hand of the man who calmed the sea, that we could learn, Lord God, that there's nothing too difficult. There's nothing outside the realm of what you're capable of doing, Father. We know our own limitations, God, and we've applied our limitations to you, God, and we ask that you would have mercy upon us, for you are limitless and fathomless, and your sources never run dry, God, and we want to see that our soul becomes a deep well, that it could be well, Lord, with my soul, that it could be well, God, with my soul. I pray that you'd bless your people, Father God, and help us to have opportunity to bless. Let's be aware and cognizant of those who are around us, Lord God, that we would surely be a blessing as an individual, as a people, as a body. Father, I pray in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. May God bless you. May you look for opportunity to be a blessing. May you look to be those who satisfy the longings. There's so many in our world that they're saturated. They need saturation. They're just so dry and empty and barren, and there's no source of hope or life within them at all. And you have water within you. Be a well. Be a well. Let your soul be a well. A wellspring of life. Amen. God bless you.